and pressing on the upward way, new heights I'm gaining every day, still praying as I'm onward.
Welcome, cherished listener, to Spotlight on the Word. Today we are going to learn very interesting lessons from what I have titled, "It is always dangerous to build on that which God wants to destroy." It's quite a lengthy title. Now, kindly turn with me to Joshua chapter 6, where we are going to look at a brief story for the background of today's lesson. Now, in Joshua chapter 6, we read about Joshua receiving instructions from the angel of Jehovah, or the commander of the army of the Lord. Those instructions were about how Israel was to take the city of Jericho. Now, what we should remember about the city of Jericho is that Jericho was one, in fact, it was the most fortified cities in the land of the Canaanites. And so this land was promised to the children of Israel. Back in Genesis chapter 15, verse 16, we read God promising Abraham. He's saying, "Now, as for you, you shall go to your fathers in peace." That was to Abraham. "You shall be buried at a good old age. But in the fourth generation, they shall return here, for the iniquity of the Amorite is not yet complete." This was the promise to Abraham, and God was fulfilling that promise, and that is what we read about in Joshua chapter 6. In fact, the promise was repeated in quite a lot of places, like Deuteronomy chapter 9. I think Numbers chapter 13 also mentioned that, and as well as Leviticus chapter 18. So, in Joshua chapter 6, when Joshua received these instructions, the Bible said in verse 12, "And Joshua rose early in the morning, and the priest took up the ark of the Lord." So they rose up early in the morning to do according to what the angel of the Lord has commanded them. Now, they marched around the city of Jericho once in a day for 6 days. But on the seventh day, they marched around the city of Jericho 7 times. After the 7th time, the priests bearing the trumpets were commanded by Joshua. And after they blew the trumpet, the people of Israel shouted with a great shout, and the wall of Jericho fell down flat, and the people went straight ahead of them, and then they took the city for themselves. So that is what we read in Joshua chapter 6. Now, when they have done all this, when they have taken the city and planted it, in verse 26, we read that Joshua charged them at that time, saying, "Cursed be the man before the Lord who rises up and builds this city Jericho. He shall lay its foundation with his firstborn, and with his youngest he shall set up its gate." So this was the prophecy that Joshua gave after Jericho was taken. But it is quite interesting that after this prophecy, or in fact also a curse, for about 500 years or more, one man rose up to build a city as against the word of Joseph. Well, I don't know whether it is from his ignorance, or he just decided to disobey God and decided to build, even though Joshua has forbidden anyone from building or rebuilding Jericho. Now, we must know the period in which this man lived, and I think that will give us a better understanding of the man's action. This man lived in a period that we call the divided kingdom, the period where Israel was divided into two kingdoms, where we have the northern kingdom being Israel and then the southern kingdom being Judah. Now, as we all know, the northern kingdom had always had evil kings, and as at the time that this man rose up to build the city of Jericho, it was the worst king that was reigning, that is in the person of Ahab, and you know Ahab's wife being Jezebel and all the evil things that she did. So it's quite interesting that even the acts or the deeds of this man that is rising up to build the city of Jericho was recorded as one of the evil things King Ahab did. Yes, because he was the king, and it was under his authority or his oversight that this city was rebuilt. Now, this man was called Hiel of Bethel. We can read of this story in 1 Kings chapter 16, verse 34. Let's quickly look at it. 1 Kings chapter 16, verse 34. In his days, Hiel of Bethel built Jericho. He laid its foundation with Abiram, his firstborn, and with his youngest son, Segub. He set up its gate according to the word of the Lord, which he had spoken through Joshua, the son of Nun. So this man rose up to build a city. And I think it could be out of ignorance, or it could also be out of disobedience, in that this period was actually characterized with a lot of evil things that Israel did. So probably, though he knew that they were not supposed to build it, but he decided to go against God's word. It could also be that since evil was so much around this time, in fact, they were not even paying attention to God's word. So this man would have not even had the opportunity to read about this prophecy. Yes, so he rose up to build the city and he paid dearly for his actions. And the Bible said when he began building, or when he laid the foundations of the city, his firstborn, that is Abiram, died. I mean, God took him away. That was the penalty for disobeying God's word. And the understanding I get from this passage is that this man probably didn't have only two sons. Probably he had two or more. And so as the work progressed, his children continued to die until when he finished everything and was setting up the gates of the city, his lastborn, called Segub, or the youngest, also did. And that is the painful thing we read about this man and how he paid dearly for disobeying God's word. Now, it is this story that I want us to consider. And remember that it is always dangerous to build on foundations that God wants to destroy. It is always dangerous to build on that which God wants to destroy. And more than what happened to this man, Hiel, can happen to us, in that we may not lose our children, though some consequences of us, our sins, may come to our children. But the ultimate of it is that we may lose our souls. We may lose our souls. Now, you know what the Bible said in Numbers chapter 23, verse 19. God will never say anything and not do it. No. Whatever he says, he will do it. And that is how come God ensured that the prophecy that he gave through Joshua came to pass. And so we have to learn from this that if we do not obey God and decide to disobey him, we'll pay dearly for our actions. So what am I trying to say? I'm saying it is always dangerous to build on what God wants to destroy. It is always dangerous to build on that. If God says this thing is not good, we must not build on such a thing. We have to desist from that. We don't have to build on such a thing, because at the end, if God says that thing will be destroyed, it will be destroyed. So it is always dangerous to build on that which God wants to destroy. And we see that in the life of Hiel of Bethel. 1 Kings chapter 16, verse 34. We can always go back and read this and remind ourselves. Now, let's apply this to ourselves. I want us to apply this to our personal lives. Now, why I'm saying that is that there are so many things we do in this life, and there are some that are not really good things. And as we continue to engage in some of those things, they become things that form our character. And at the end of the day, since we are identified by our character, our entire life depends on those things. And that is why it is very important that whichever thing that we are using to build, we should make sure that they are the right things. We should make sure that we are building on the right foundations. So when we read 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 9, the Bible says something in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 9. It said, "Do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor homosexuals, nor sodomites, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners will inherit the kingdom of God." So this is what the apostle was telling us, that people who engage in some of those things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Now, I see these things as things that are not good, things that are bad foundations. If we should build on any of those things, is it about covetousness? Is it about drunkenness? Is it about extortion? Is it about thievery? I mean, name it. All those things that the apostle mentioned here are things that will not help us. They are unrighteous. We build our lives, our personal lives, on some of those things. At the end of the day, we are going to lose our lives. It will be just like Hiel, who built on wrong foundations, or foundations that were cursed, and at the end of the day, he lost his children because of that. When we build on some of those things, at the end of the day, we are going to lose our souls. Galatians chapter 5 verse 19 also talks about many of those things, that we should not engage in those things because these things will not help us to inherit the kingdom of God. So I'm appealing to us that whatever we, or whatever life that we are living, we should make sure that the things we are using to build our lives are things that are good, are things that have been approved by God, not things that are against God. Because at the end of the day, when we use such things to build our lives will just shatter at some day to come, because we have built on wrong foundation. We have built on the wrong foundation, and our life will just fall and then break up just like that, because we have built on wrong foundation. And so, brethren, I want to encourage each one listening to this audio that look at yourself, look at your personal life. Are there some habits that you are engaging in? Are there some things that you are doing that you know that when you don't stop those things, they'll become part of you, they'll become part of your character, and at the end of the day, you'll not be able to do away with certain things, and your life will be dependent on those things. And when these things are tested, you realize that your life is just falling apart because you are engaging in those things that are not good, that are not good for a foundation. So please, let us consider our lives and see if we are building on any wrong foundations, and let us desist from building on wrong foundations, but rather foundations that have been approved by God. Now, I would like us to also look at something from Matthew chapter 7. Jesus said something at Matthew chapter 7 verse 24 to 27. Now in Matthew chapter 7 verse 24 to 27, therefore whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain descended, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, and it did not fall, for it was founded on the rock. He's talking about good foundation. But everyone who hears these sayings of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. And the rain descended, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, and it fell, and great was its fall. This is what Jesus is saying, that when you build on wrong foundations, when the rains come, when the wind blows, at the end of the day, the foundation is going to be destroyed. And you, such a person, will be called a foolish man. And in fact, if God calls you a foolish man, it means you are foolish indeed. And so this is the warning Jesus gave, that for us to avoid building on cursed foundations, foundations that are dangerous, foundations that are not approved by God, Jesus says we should listen to his words and rather build our lives on his words. That is why I say that it is always dangerous to build on wrong foundations. And so let us rather build on the words of Jesus. And of course, Jesus will not approve of these things I have mentioned in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 9 to 11. He will not approve of these things that are listed in Galatians chapter 5, verse 19. All these things are not in line with the words of Jesus. And so we must not build our lives on those things, because at the end of the day, just as the foolish man built on a foundation that wasn't good, and the rains came and the wind blew, and then at the end of the day, the foundations or the entire building was destroyed, that is the same thing that is going to happen to us. An ancient philosopher says, watch your thoughts, they become your words. Watch your words, they become your actions. Watch your actions, they become your habits.
Watch your habit, they become your character. Watch your character, it becomes your destiny. So at the end of the day, those things that we build our lives upon will determine how our life will end. And that is why it is important that we build on good foundations. Remember Hiel of Bethel. He built on wrong foundation, a cursed foundation, and at the end of the day, he lost his children. And that is the same way that when we build on wrong foundations in our personal life, we will lose our life. One aspect of our life that I want to talk about is our religious life. How are we building our religious life? Is it on the wrong foundation or the right foundation? Are we building on foundations that God wants to destroy, or we are building on foundations that God has approved? Now, when it comes to the area of salvation, there are many who think they have been saved when they have actually not been saved. Some talk about grace alone. Some talk about faith only. Some talk about works only, and a whole lot of things. But the question is, what are we supposed to know when it comes to salvation? What are we supposed to know when it comes to salvation? The Bible gives us what we are supposed to know about salvation. Now, in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 to 9, it says, "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast." What are we talking about here? It is by the grace of God that we have been saved through faith. Yeah, there is nothing like you have been saved through grace only, or you have been saved through faith only, or you have been saved through works or whatever. He said, it is by the grace of God that you have been saved through faith. It's as simple as that. People try to make salvation, in fact, they try to manufacture a way that they want to be saved. But that is not what we are supposed to do. We will just end up like Hiel by trying to build on a wrong foundation. We should build on a foundation that God has laid for our salvation. He says we have been saved by grace through faith. Grace in that it is God who reached out to us. In Romans chapter 5 verse 7 to 8, that God demonstrated his love toward us. Even while we were still in our sins, Christ came to die for us. Yes, none of us could have done it, or none of us could have saved himself. Christ died for us. That is the grace. God, through his benevolence or his generosity, gave us his word for us to know his will and to guide us to know what to do when it comes to salvation. And God is saying that he has saved us by grace through our faith. Grace on the part of God and all the beautiful things God has done for us. Now, faith comes to how we respond to God's grace, how we must appropriate the grace of God in our lives. And that is talking about obedient faith, not faith where you will just accept in your mind or in your heart that, oh, I believe God exists, I believe Jesus Christ is Lord, and that is it, that's all. I am done, I am saved. No. In fact, in Ephesians chapter 2, when we talk about faith, the Bible is talking about an active faith. Faith that is active, faith that is obedient, faith that will move you to do everything God has asked you to do. Just like the faith of Abraham. Abraham didn't just say, I have faith in God and that's all. No, he had faith in God even to the point that Abraham was supposed to move out from where he was living to a different place where he didn't even know all the facts about this place. But he was able to, obey God and acted upon that faith. That is the faith we are talking about. That is the faith we are talking about. In fact, people say he was moving to a place without a map because he didn't know how everything was going to work out for him. But he trusted God. That is the faith we are talking about. Not a mental acceptance that, oh, I believe God and that's all. No. So when we are talking about salvation by grace through faith, we are talking about salvation by grace where God has done everything for us and has shown us the way we can access his grace. And God says we should believe the gospel about Jesus Christ, and then we should repent of our sins, we should confess our sins, and then we should give our life to Christ through baptism and stay faithfully in his kingdom. People are not ready to look at it. This is the foundation when it comes to salvation. Now, people are building on a foundation of denominationalism, where people are not ready to accept the doctrine of the one true church in scripture. People want to be anywhere they want to be. In fact, every church is as good as the other. That is what we always hear. But meanwhile, Paul spoke openly against such a thing, that we are not supposed to be divided. I mean, Christ is the one who died for the church, and we are supposed to be members of the church that Christ purchased with his own blood. Paul says, "Now I plead with you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you all speak the same thing, and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. For it has been declared to me concerning you, my brethren, by those of close household, that there are contentions among you. Now I say this, that each of you says, I am of Paul, or I am of Apollos, or I am of Cephas, or I am of Christ. Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you, or were you baptized in the name of Paul?" These are the questions that the apostle Paul, that is from 1 Corinthians chapter 1, reading from verse 10 to 12. These are the questions that the apostle asked the people in Corinth. That was Paul crucified for you people? Were you baptized into the name of Paul? In fact, is Christ divided? But today we have people who will say that, oh, unity and diversity. So everybody wakes up every day and thinks that I've received a dream, I've received a revelation from God. I'm going to establish my own church, name it my own name, and then practice what teachings that I want to practice. And we think it is all good. No, we are building on wrong foundations. If you are in any of the denominations, I will plead with you that you better look for the better foundation, the church which Christ established, the church that Christ himself became the foundation of that church. And there is no other foundation apart from him, Christ. There is no foundation apart from him, Christ. He is the foundation of the church. As we read in 1 Corinthians chapter 3 verse 11, he says, "For no other foundation can anyone lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ." And he is the foundation. And that is the same thing he said in Matthew chapter 16 verse 18, that upon this rock I will build my church. Upon the fact that he is Christ, upon that truth, he, Christ, was going to build his church. So you see, now there are so many of us who are in denominations that the foundation of this denomination, it's out of someone's private interpretation of a scripture, or someone's private dream, or someone's private vision that he claims he has had from God, and we are all following those teachings. And most of these denominations, their teachings are just, in fact, contrary to what the Bible teaches. Brethren, please, I would advise that if you are listening to this audio and you are in these denominations, please, you have to make a U-turn. You have to make a change. Paul had to make a change when he encountered Christ. So, denominationalism is one of the false or the wrong foundation. In fact, it's a cursed foundation because Paul spoke against it. And so, for you to be in a denomination, you are building your salvation, or you are building your religious life on a wrong foundation. Now, when it comes to the area of worship, it is the same thing we see, that people want to worship God by the way they feel, by what they think, by what they want, but forgetting that worship is not about the individual. Worship is about God. We worship God for who he is, and we worship God for what God has done for us. We don't worship God because we want to entertain ourselves. We don't worship God because of that. And that is why we must be careful that even in the area of worship, we'll be worshiping or we'll be building on wrong foundations. For the area of worship, I just want to let us look at just one thing. And that will be John chapter 4, verse 23 to 24. It says, "But the hour is coming, and now is, when the true worshippers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father is seeking such to worship him. God is a spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and truth." Worshipping God out of the heart, not we waiting for some kind of external stimulations or sensations, like we being a concert kind of environment before we will be moved to worship God. No,
We don't need this external sensation. We don't need this kind of outward things to motivate us to worship God. No. I say we worship God because of who He is and what He has done for us. Can't we imagine how great God is, and He being a great God who has created this world and all the beautiful things we are seeing? In fact, let's look at our lives, ourselves as human beings, and how God has created us. Can't we find any reason to worship God because He's wonderful? And we are now waiting to hear the drum before we move to worship God. We are now waiting to hear the organ before we worship God. And this has generated a lot of false foundations for worship. And so let us worship God for who He is. And He says, now is the time. God is seeking for true worshipers to worship Him in spirit and in truth. Worshipping Him out of our heart and out of a sincere and a pure heart. Now, God is also seeking for us to worship Him in truth, not based on what we want. God's word is the truth, and we have to worship Him according to what God has prescribed, according to what God has asked us to do. We do not worship Him because we feel good, because we want to do this, because we think that this is better. No, 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 no. We are not the center of worship. God is the center of worship. So let us not build on false foundations when it comes to the area of worship. Let us not build on wrong foundations. If not, we are going to lose our lives. Just like Hiel of Bethel lost his children because he decided to build on a foundation that was cursed. Now, the third aspect I want us to talk about is the aspect of our life as citizens of Ghana. And in fact, I want us to look at Ghana as a nation. Since we are all citizens of Ghana, I believe when we do our part, it will help. Now, what I see is that the nation is building on a wrong foundation. The nation is building on a wrong foundation. In Psalm 11, verse 3, the psalmist asked, "If the foundations are destroyed, what can the righteous do?" So if we sit down for the foundations to be destroyed, what will we who call ourselves Christians, what are we going to do at the end? Now here, I would like to talk about foundations as the moral support of the country, or the moral foundation of the country. Things that are supposed to be held high, these things are being destroyed. Yes, these things are being destroyed. And if we sit down, just like the psalmist asked, if the foundations are destroyed, what are we going to do? Now, in Ghana, we read so many times from the news where people are murdering people just like that. People go to people's house and go and murder them. People murder nurses and workers who are coming back from work and all that. And then so many things are going on. And sometimes we are quick to react to news concerning murder in America and other places. Meanwhile, within our country, the same thing is going on. People are killing people secretly and then dumping people at places that is not supposed to be done. And when we come to Ghana, also people have compromised with the teachings on divorce. Even Christians, people who call themselves gospel musicians, people who call themselves pastors and men of God, are even engaging in one divorce or the other. Understand? And then we claim we are a nation that is religious. People are becoming people of unbelief. In fact, unbelief is on the rise. People think that it is religion that is making Ghana not develop. And I always like what Dr. Dan Wisesiama always says, that it is not a religion that impedes the growth of this country, but rather false religion or pseudo-religion is what impedes the growth of this country. And it is true. So many people think that we don't need to believe in God because, after all, Christianity and whatever, they are making things difficult in this country. People are lying to people, false prophets and all that. It is because we are not seeking after the right religion. And that is why these things are happening. We talk about things like abortion. People are committing abortion. Ladies are involved in fact, they consume contraceptives like anything. People take abortifacients and all that. And we think everything is right. The psalmist said, if the foundations are destroyed, what will the righteous do?
In Ghana, now we talk about the culture of insult, where people sit on radio and then they talk and insult others, and children are also learning it. We saw all these things when this WASI began. When people are insulting the president, students are insulting authorities and all that. Now we see on social media where people expose their body, nudity is everywhere. And people are fighting over things that are not important, things that are not purposeful. These are some of the things that are going on. I'm saying that if we sit down for the foundations to be destroyed, what will the righteous do? And it is funny now that we don't see those things. We have blinded our eyes and we think that everything is all right. David gave us the answer. In fact, in verse 1 of the Psalm 11, he said, "In the Lord I put my trust. How can you say to my soul, flee as a bird to your mountain?" We need to flee to God and put our trust in God, just as David was saying here. And I believe that that is the way we are going to help restore the moral foundations of our nation, Ghana. So we have spoken about three areas: our personal lives, we have spoken about our religious life, we've spoken about our lives as citizens of Ghana, that when we don't build on the right foundation, in all these instances, it is going to affect us. It is going to affect us. And so we need to repent, we need to change, we need to assess ourselves if we are building on cursed foundations. Just as Joshua prophesied about the foundation of Jericho, that anyone who builds on it would pay dearly for it. That is the same way that God has already declared this the penalty for building on some of those things I have discussed. Being it the things that I've discussed in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 9 to 11, or Galatians 5, 19, or talking about rebuilding on denominationalism, rebuilding on false doctrines about salvation, rebuilding on false worship, and then also we engaging in things that are not right, things that are undermining the moral support of our country. All these things are going to make us lose our lives. In this case, not the lives of our children, but our own lives. And what would a man give in exchange for his soul? What shall it profit us if we gain the whole world and lose our soul? So if you're a Christian and you are listening to me, or if you're a child of God and you are listening to me, and for quite some time now you have realized that you have veered from the path that God has shown us in the scriptures, and you are now building on false foundations, then all that I ask is that you repent and come back to God. And begin to build on the right foundations. Begin to build on things that are right. Begin to seek and to appropriate your life as the grace that you have been given has accorded you. Now, I think we'll have to read something from Philippians chapter 4. Philippians chapter 4 verse 8 tells us that, "Finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there is any virtue and if there is anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things." Remember the quote we said, that things that you think about, things that you practice, they eventually become your character, and your character eventually determines your destiny. And so that is the same thing the Apostle Paul is saying. We should think and meditate on these things. Things that are noble, things that are just, things that are pure, things that are lovely, and things that are of good report. He says we should think about those things, things that are true. These are the things that will help us to be able to build on the right foundation. This is a foundation that God has shown us, that we should build on it. And at the end of the day, we are going to be successful. However, if you are not a Christian, you have not become a child of God, then there is the need for you to also hear the gospel of Christ. And what we are talking about the gospel is that Christ came to die for you and I, our sins. It's for our sake. He came to die in our stead. And therefore, we need to repent of all our sins. Christ came to die for us. And when we are willing to listen, we are willing to accept these words about Jesus and the great sacrifice that he has done for us, we receive life in ourselves. We receive life because we have died. We have been in sin and we are not alive. we have died so long, and we need to be alive to God. We need to listen to God's word, and it is God's word that gives us that life, that revives us. And that is why Romans 10 says that, verse 17 says, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And that is how we are going to receive faith. And therefore, all I'm saying is that today, if you have heard about the fact that when you build upon wrong foundations, you are going to lose your life, make sure you build on the right foundation. And the right foundation is Jesus Christ. The right foundation is Jesus. He is the foundation, and he has given us all that it takes for us to even build on him, the foundation. And at the end of the day, if we build on Jesus, we are going to make it. So I'm saying that if you are still in your sins, if you have not given your life to Christ, you need to repent. Believe that Christ came to die for us. Christ came to die for our sins. He was buried. He resurrected. And he's on the right-hand side of God, interceding for us. And so we need to give our life to him so that he can intercede on our behalf. And at the end of the day, I believe that we will be at a better place when we die. We need to believe in Christ. Hebrews 11 verse 6 that, for it is impossible for anyone to please God. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. So we need to believe what Christ has done for us, and we need to put our trust, we need to put our faith in him. And here, as I've been saying, we are not talking about mental acceptance only. No, we need to have the faith that will help us to do all that Christ has asked us to do. So if Christ asks us to forgive our enemies, we need to forgive our enemies. If Christ asks us to love our enemies, we need to love our enemies. If Christ asks us to do something, we need to do it. And that is the faith we are talking about. We don't sit down and say that, okay, we believe in God and that's all. No. So we need to believe in Christ. Now in Acts chapter 17, verse 30 to 31 also tells us that we need to repent, for God has appointed a day that he will judge all of us, will judge all men. And so all men, we need to repent. Acts 17, verse 30 to 31. It says that, truly, these times of ignorance God overlooked, but now commands all men everywhere to repent. What has God overlooked? God overlooked for the fact that in those times, God didn't reveal or didn't talk about how the judgment was going to be and all that. Why? Because he has not yet appointed a judge. Now, in our times, a judge has been appointed, and that is in the person of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And therefore, we need to repent from our sins, because he has appointed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by the man whom he has ordained. He has given assurance of this to all by raising him from the dead. And that is it. That is why you need to believe in Christ and give your life to Christ. So let us repent from all our sins. Let us repent from everything that we are doing that is against God and his word, so that we will give our lives to God. Now let us also confess the lordship of Jesus Christ. Romans chapter 10 verse 9. Let us confess the lordship of Jesus Christ. And I believe that when we do that, it is not just by confessing with our mouth, but as Matthew chapter 10 verse 32 also told us to confess Christ before all men. And that confession is talking about our lives. We confess Christ with our lives. I believe that when we do that, we are on the right path, or we are on the path, or we are building on the foundation that Christ has shown us. Now we need to also be baptized. We give our lives to Christ through baptism. Now in Acts chapter 2, Peter gave us another approach on how to build when it comes to salvation. In Acts chapter 2 verse 36, let's read from 36. Peter said, therefore let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. Now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? So just like these people, they were asking how to begin, upon which foundation should they build. Then Peter said to them, repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. So it means that for us to build on the right foundation, we need to be baptized and give our lives to Christ. We need to be baptized. We need to repent and be baptized for forgiveness of our sins. And then we will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Mark chapter 16, verse 15 to 16 also spells the same thing, that we need to believe and be baptized. And then also one thing we need to do, 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 2 says that it is required of stewards that they be found faithful. And therefore, after we have been baptized and be added to the church that belongs to Christ, we need to remain faithful to God. Revelation chapter 2, verse 10 says that we should be faithful unto death, and He, or God, will give us the crown of life. And so we need to remain faithful even after we have been baptized into Christ. And I tell you, there is no foundation that is as better than this foundation that we are discussing here. So if you are not a child of God, you need to believe in Christ and the sacrifice that He has come to do for us. We need to repent of our sins. We need to confess by our mouth and also by our lives. And we need to be baptized into Christ. And then we need to stay faithful in Christ's church and continue to work in His kingdom. And I believe that as we do that, we are constantly building on the right foundation. And at the end of the day, we wouldn't be like Hiel of Bethel, who lost his children because he built on a wrong foundation. So if you are listening to me today, all that I will encourage you to do is that strive to continue to build on the right foundation. Build on foundations that God has approved, not foundations that God wants them to be destroyed, not foundations that God has cursed, not foundations that are not right in the sight of God, but build on foundation that is right in the sight of God. And the ultimate of it all is Jesus Christ. He is the foundation. He is the beginning of everything. And Jesus has taught us good things, things that we should do that will help us to live good lives. And so, brethren, when it comes to our personal life, let us build on the right foundation. When it comes to our religious life, let us build on the right foundation. When it comes to our lives as Ghanaians, let us build on the right foundation. And I believe that at the end of the day, we will not be like Hiel of Bethel. So remember, today we've learned that it is always dangerous to build on that which God wants to destroy. It is always dangerous to build on the wrong foundations. May God bless you as you have listened. And I pray that you keep following Spotlight on the Word and listening to our videos, our audios, and all the wonderful things that we bring your way for the purpose of furthering the cause of the gospel. May God bless you. In Jesus' name, amen.
I'm pressing on the upward way. New heights I'm gaining every day. Still praying as I'm onward bound. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand. By faith on hand, the same old land. Higher play than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground.
What?